Welcome to Milkshake Mondays. It's episode 3, July the 2nd, 2018. We're going to talk about a lot tonight, so I have to dive right in. If you have your Bibles, go to 2 Kings chapter 6, and let me tell you what's going on. There is a priest, and it's Elisha. And Elisha is basically causing problems for the king of Syria, who's in battle with Israel. And what happens is, the reason why I tell you this story before I tell you the main story is because I want to have you focus on something spiritual. Not trying to be big words or not, but here's what's going to happen. Every time the king of Syria is about to attack, Elijah, the man of God, gets word to the king of Israel and says, hey, they're going to be here. They're going to be here. So don't take your people that way. Well, the king of Syria said, what is going on? And he said, you know, there's a man of God in town, and he's telling all your secrets, king. So they get upset, and he says, okay, go get this guy. Bring him to me. So here we are in chapter 6 of 2 Kings, and this is what's going on. It says basically in verse 14, therefore, meaning the king, he sent horses and chariots and a great army there, and they came by night and surrounded the city. Now you got to imagine this. This is kind of funny when you see this part. Verse 15 says, and when the servant of the man of God arose early and went out, you can imagine he's tired, waking up in the morning like we all are, and he opens the tent, and it says, and there was an army surrounding the city with horses and chariots. And his servant said to him, alas, my master, what shall we do? He's like all of us. He'd be freaking out. So verse 16 says, so he answered, do not fear, because that's the first thing. When we see something going on in our lives, we start to freak out and fear. And that's something that as I go into the main part of the story, I want you to say, sometimes what you see with your eyes is not what God sees. And what today's teaching is going to be is our eyes don't see what God sees. And because we don't see what God sees, we are finding ourselves in fear and we don't know what to do. And oftentimes we make bad decisions. So here's what goes on. So imagine this servant sees all of these horses and he sees all this warfare coming against him and his master. And here's what goes on, verse 16. So he answered, do not fear, for those who are with us are more than those who are with them. And you can imagine the servant said, what? So verse 17 says, and Elisha prayed and said, Lord, I pray, open his eyes that he may see. Then the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw, and behold, the mountains was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. The bottom line on that was the people that were, not people, but the force that God had brought in support of Elisha and the servant was far more than what the king of Syria had done. So he said, why do I start this off? Because a lot of times what we see in the natural, what we go to work, where we go to school, where we go in the house, where we go in the grocery store, where we go in our families, what we see causes us to overreact. But I want you to know that not only do we overreact, we make bad decisions. And that's what the main of the story is going to be. We're going to go into 1 Samuel chapter 16. Now, the reason why I showed you something spiritual, because a lot of people will say, well, I don't get to see in the supernatural every day. So why are you bringing this up to me? Because I want you to see that even in our natural lives, in our day-to-day lives, we are making decisions by what we see, but we don't understand that God has got something totally different that he's seeing. And I want us to slow down. We just had a teaching this past Friday where God, through my husband, taught us about when you're in trouble, when you're in a crisis, that there's 5 steps that you need to think about. Stop, wait, get consultation, pray, and then decide. I want you to look at what's going on in this passage of scripture. This is background. Saul was a man that was picked for the nation of Israel to be king. They decided they didn't want God to be their king. They wanted a king like everybody else. Well, what set Saul apart is that he was tall. He was handsome. And they picked him by those outward characteristics. Well, when Samuel asked him to do something, he disobeyed. And God said, no, I don't want you to disobey me. I'm going to take the crown away from you. No longer do you be king of Israel. So what happens here in verse 16, it says, now the Lord said to Samuel, how long will you mourn for Saul, seeing I've rejected him? In our lives, we tend to mourn and be upset and then pity parties and all kinds of drama and depression and despair because what God has rejected and said is not good for your life. I don't want that person for you. I don't want that situation. I don't want that circumstance. We hang on to it, and we're all having a bad day, a bad few months, bad few years, because we're regretting having to keep something. God says, it's not good for you. I don't want you to have it. But look what he tells to Samuel to do. I want you to go. I want you to go to the town, and I want you to find Jesse, the Bethlehemite, and I want you to anoint the person that I have for myself as king. Now, if you're looking at what's going on in this story, God has already told him, I'm going to send you someplace. I'm going to tell you the guy's father, and I'm going to have you pick him. But look what happens in this story. We're going to start at verse 6. So imagine that he's coming to the town. He's told the people he's there to do a sacrifice. All along, he's on a mission to find the next king. But he doesn't want Saul to know about it, else Saul would kill him. So this is what happens in verse 6. So it was when they came, talking about the sons of Jesse. Here's what Samuel does. He looked at Eliab and said, surely the Lord's anointed is before him. Why did he say that? Because the guy's good looking. And that's what we do. We make decisions on the outward appearance, and God is getting ready to tell us, I don't do that. I don't use my eyes like you use your eyes. I see something deeper than the superficial that all of us tend to judge on. But look what God says. It says here, verse 7, but the Lord said to Samuel, do not look at his appearance or at his physical stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord does not see as a man sees. For man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. That's the crux of what I want to talk about. We are making decisions, life-changing decisions, based on what we see. That man looks good. That woman looks fine. That job, lots of money. Oh, that house, 5 bedrooms, 3-car garage. Oh, I'm gonna choose that vacation spot. Oh, I want that diamond. Oh, that kid looks really good. I want her to be friends with my kid. Oh, all these superficial things. And God is saying, that's not how I look at things. I don't see people because they're fat, they're skinny. I don't see people because they're dark skin, they're light skin, they're white, they're black, they're Asian, they're Hispanic. I don't look at that stuff. You all look at this stuff, but I look and judge people for their heart. Well, look what goes on. Jesse starts to show he has 8 different sons. He prances before Samuel, 7 of them. If you go to verse 10, it says, thus Jesse made 7 of his sons pass before Samuel. And Samuel said to Jesse, the Lord has not chosen these. And what happens? And Samuel said to Jesse, are all your young men here? When I talk about looking, you will see that the priest made decisions based on superficial, and God said, no, 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 no. The father had 8 sons, but yet he only decided to show the man of God for a potential position of king, 7 of them. The father was short-sighted. He only saw 7 of his sons as potential candidates. He knew he had 8. It's not like he forgot about the 8, but he had made a decision in his mind. God didn't want that little one. God didn't want that person. He's for whatever reasons the father did, he didn't even think about his other son. And the Samuel had to say, do you have any more? Because God surely knows that he has his appointed king, because he sent me here. He told me you were his father, and I've gone through 7 of these sons, and he's rejected them all. But here's what happened. So verse 12 says, so he sent and brought him in. Now he, talking about David, was ruddy, some people say healthy, with bright eyes and good looking. And the Lord said, arise, anoint him, for this is the one. Many of us are picking the wrong one because we're looking at outward appearances. If you know anything about King David, it always says that David was a man after God's own heart. And many of us are overlooking people to be in relationships. And I'm not just talking about physical relationships, boyfriend, girlfriend, husband, wife. I'm talking about friendships. I'm talking about companionship. I'm talking about people to be in your life to be a witness to, because they don't look like you, or you're judging them. God is putting different people in front of your path to share the good news of who Christ is. It's not going to be who you expect. It will be the person that you don't expect. They could be going through a problem. they could come up to you and they look sad. Or you see them sitting by themselves and you're like, well, I don't think I want to sit by myself. Maybe I'll go over there and sit with them. And maybe you'll just encourage them. But because of the outward appearance of people, oh, they may look poor. Oh, they may look rich. Oh, they may look like they're a different culture. They don't speak my language. Oh, they look like this. We judge and we miss opportunities where the Holy Spirit is saying, I wanted you to go and talk to them and meet with them and get involved in their lives. We are choosing not to be involved because of what we see, how we're judging other people. But God says he looks at people's heart, and we have to be like God and start having the eyes of God and start to do the work of Christ. And just like that servant that was seeing all of those soldiers and freaking out, he was afraid. We have to stop being afraid of people that don't look like us, that don't seem like us, that don't smell like us, that don't act like us. Because God says the harvest is ripe, but the laborers are few. And our laborers are afraid, and our laborers are using their eyes to discount other people. And God doesn't want that. And he's saying to many of us, I have a purpose for your life. And it doesn't matter what your father has said of you. It doesn't matter what your mother and your sisters have said of you. If you look at that last part of the verse, when it says that God selected him, it says in Samuel, verse 13, then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brothers. Now you think about those brothers. Those brothers, the other seven, were rejected. The other brothers were rejected and refused by the Lord Almighty, and their little brother was identified as the next king. Do you think there's some family drama about to happen? There will be, I'm sure. Just like Joseph, the young brother, they hated him. There are some things in your life where God may move you out front. And it's not for yourself, selfish interest. It's for you to do the very work of the divine God that he wants to do in your life. And it doesn't matter if you're the youngest or the oldest. If God says you're the one, you're the one. And some of us are in a place in our lives, whether we're young or old, and we're doing something for the last 30 years. You have to be ready to say, God, here I am, send me. Many of the times at the end of the scripture that I teach, I'll share with you an invitation to come to know Christ. There aren't that many ways to say what I want to say, other than there's a time and a season of each of our lives. We have the beginning of our lives at our birth, and we have the end of our natural lives here. A lot of us are spending a lot of wasted time doing a lot of meaningless tasks, doing a lot of meaningless things that at the end of our lives don't give glory to God. I want you to take this week and see what it is God has for you to do in this world. And if you have not made that decision that Jesus Christ is important, I mean, that's the basic. Is he important enough for you to sit down and stop and say, what do I have to do in this life to get to know him? It's not a secret. It's not a big, magnificent task, but it is a task that all of us have to do before we go before the Lord and say, what did we do with our lives? I want each of us to take this time to just say, God, help me see who you are in my life. And if some of you are putting him on the back burner and you just don't care, you just don't care. God is not important. Everything but God is important. The time is winding up. I've gone to funerals after funerals after funeral from young and old. And I'm telling you, we're wasting a lot of time playing games. But God is saying, come, give your life to Christ. Open your eyes and see who Jesus Christ is. And you'll see he's waiting there with open arms of love for you. Don't be afraid. Ask him into your heart today. Thank you so much for joining us for Milkshake Monday. We'll see you next week. God bless you and I love you.